Well, as you can see here, we have a great infestation of water hemp, and there's a lot of strengths to this weed. One of them is high seed production, and all of these plants have viable seed on them right now, or for the most part, the female plants do. I just grabbed just a tip of one of the stems, and there's probably at least 50 to 100 viable water hemp seed in my hand right now. About 7 days after pollination, we have viable seed produced. And so pollination occurred probably something like a month or more ago. And that's really the problem with water hemp, is how much seed can be produced. And what happens when the combine goes through these plants, it becomes the perfect spreader of this seed. We couldn't do it any better if we tried. And so that's kind of what's happened with why we've got to this point. You've got a couple of things all meshing together to make it kind of the perfect storm. Each of these plants can produce anywhere from 300,000 to almost a million seed per plant. And so that's a big strength of water hemp. Another strength of water hemp is that it can germinate pretty much throughout the year. We can find some water hemp germinating right now here at soybean harvest. If it gets an opportunity, it can do so. It's kind of rare, but no problem for water hemp to germinate in July and August, and it is a continuous emerger. It's also a fairly fast growing weed. We've done some research that shows this plant in the height of the growing season, when we're trying to manage it, it's generally going to grow 1.5 inches per day. One of the things that we know as far as its weakness is it does not persist long in the soil. All of our recommendations for water hemp now center around this one fact, and that is that we want to prevent seed, water hemp seed, glyphosate resistant water hemp seed, from going back into that soil seed bank to be a problem in future years. If we attack it from that standpoint, we will be able to manage this weed much more efficiently than we have. In this four soybean row area here, we have four rows wide by about 30 feet long, where we've applied glyphosate at the labeled rate in two different applications on small water hemp plants earlier in the season. And here we are almost at harvest, and you can see that this is in fact a glyphosate resistant water hemp population. Those applications did no good, and now we're going to obviously have severe yield loss, and we have a lot of water hemp plants that survived and can produce seed and put on the soil. So this is kind of the comparison treatment. Here's a different treatment. Again, we have the same setup, four rows wide. I'm sitting in the exact middle of this particular plot, and you can see we have no water hemp. It's a clean treatment where we've managed this glyphosate resistant water hemp problem. So what's the difference? What's going on here? This was a conventional till situation, so we tilled, put on our pre-emergence herbicide, and then planted the soybeans. And after that, what's kind of the key and the new direction that we must be moving in for water hemp management in Missouri is not only a residual herbicide, but we came back when the water hemp broke through, and we applied a glyphosate, amisofen, which is a, we call it a PPO inhibitor, and also a residual herbicide at that time as well. What I call that is overlapping residuals. So we put on a pre-emergence herbicide at planting. That is only going to last us a certain amount of time. When we come back with our post-emergence treatment, we put on a residual herbicide at that time as well. And that should get us through the season as it's done here. So we're overlapping that spectrum of residual herbicide activity. And we are going to have to rely on residual herbicides to manage this water hemp problem. We are quickly running out of post-emergence herbicide options for our pigweed problems in Missouri. So we've seen two examples so far. Here's a third example, and it represents another way that I feel we should be moving forward with our recommendations for water hemp management in Missouri specifically. This particular plot, again, four rows wide. I'm basically standing in the middle of the treatment where we have sprayed, four rows wide by about 30 feet long, and you can see it's very clean, no water hemp present at a site where we have tremendous populations of glyphosate-resistant water hemp. So what is different here is the concept of full rate of residual. That is another recommendation that we're moving forward with. Not only should we be applying a residual herbicide in our soybean production systems, but we need to think more about applying a full labeled rate of that product. For example, this is a treatment, the product name is called Authority First. One of the common ways that we have been applying Authority First is 3.2 ounces of product per acre. The label allows you to spray 6.4 ounces of Authority First per acre. This is sulfentrazone and chloranzalam are the two active ingredients in that product. And so you can see we have gotten excellent control because we've put on the full labeled rate of this herbicide. And in this case, we came back with a glyphosate and a fomicifen FlexStar application, which is a PPO inhibiting herbicide, for those few escapes that were here. I doubt that we're ever going to have a year where we get complete control of all water hemp with a residual herbicide only. Sometimes you may get it, but it's a fairly risky scenario, so you're likely still going to have to come back with something post-emergence. You just want to, in this particular concept, you're putting more of your eggs up front in that basket in comparison to later in the season post-emergence. And we find that to be an effective way of managing this glyphosate-resistant water hemp problem. Again, this is a site where we have our glyphosate-resistant water hemp research. This is a different technology other than the Roundup Ready. This is LibertyLink soybeans. So you have a whole different new mode of action post-emergence for water hemp in this case. Glufosinate or Ignite you can use on glyphosate-resistant species. And as you can see here in this particular treatment, in between these two rows where we've treated, we've done well with this technology. What has occurred here is we put on a pre-emergence herbicide, which I would still recommend even in LibertyLink soybean production. But the catch is you have a post-emergence herbicide that is effective still to this point on glyphosate-resistant water hemp. And so we came in when the water hemp was about 3 inches or so in height after it had broken through those pre-emergence treatments, and we sprayed Ignite or glufosinate on small water hemp plants. And that's the key with this technology, is it can work. It is a different mechanism of action that's still effective on water hemp, but we must be treating small water hemp when we're treating. And again, I would still recommend a pre-emergence herbicide in this system. So this treatment has had a pre-emergence herbicide, and because of the season we've had, where we had multiple flushes of water hemp, we actually had two applications of Ignite here. Pretty much 100% of our yield that would have been here for us to get. And that's the goal. So our third recommendation moving forward with the glyphosate-resistant water hemp problem that we have in Missouri is for you to consider the use of LibertyLink soybeans and that technology. The way you're going to have to use that is still include a pre-emergence herbicide and timely applications of glufosinate on your weeds. But if you do those two things, you can make this technology work on your glyphosate-resistant weed problem.
Herbicide-resistant weeds are currently impacting agriculture on an unprecedented scale. Each year, herbicide-resistant weed populations occur with increasing frequency in response to the selection pressure imposed on them by modern crop production techniques. In order to prevent this situation from degrading further, producers must have a change in their mindset of weed management. For the most part, weed management decisions are currently based on single-year economic thresholds. However, in order to stop the spread and progression of herbicide-resistant weed populations, producers must think longer term and diversify their weed management techniques. This includes considering all available chemical, cultural, mechanical weed control methods, with the ultimate goal of eliminating weed seeds from the soil seed bank. Because many current herbicides have the same mechanisms of action, producers must understand herbicide mechanism of action and frequently rotate to herbicides that have different mechanisms of action so that resistant weeds do not predominate our production systems. Ultimately, the focus must shift from a single to a multifaceted approach. This way, producers can not only improve their weed management, but they can also be an effective part of the effort to prevent the further spread of herbicide-resistant weeds.